it's always important to commemorate these occasions. It's probably more pertinent now more than ever at this time, because I can't recall a time in recent memory when we have seen so many signs about white power and expressions of white power. It's a very, I guess, disturbing climate at the moment. So it's probably even more pertinent to remind everybody now about the dangers, the dangerous roads that this kind of climate can lead to. Now, Babi Yar, we're coming up to the 80th anniversary of the events of Babi Yar. And I just wanted to just discuss with you just the events, what happened, what led up to it, what happened on the 29th of September and the 30th of September, how that area, that ravine just outside of Kiev, continued to operate as a killing field and as a concentration camp, and then the aftermath. So Simon, in a nutshell, just orientate us about Babi Yar, about what it was and how it stands in the history of the Holocaust.
Sure. Well, thanks, Jim. Look, Babi Yar was, as you mentioned, it occurred at the end of September in 1941. And this was as part of the German war against the Soviet Union, which commenced in the summer of the same year. And it's that invasion of the Soviet Union that sees for the first time the use of this concept that they refer to as the final solution to the Jewish question. And as people, of course, are well aware, the persecution of Jews within Nazi Germany and within those occupied territories from the beginning of the war onwards was something that had been proceeding already for some time. But up until this point in time, the perpetrators of these crimes had always been envisaging some kind of territorial solution, the possibility that Jews would simply be deposited elsewhere, that they might be moved on to some other location, wherever that other location might be. It's really only from the middle of 1941 that they begin to pursue a policy of extermination. It's only from the very end of 1941, as a matter of fact, that it now becomes officially prohibited for Jews to leave the area of German control, that they're no longer encouraged to find some place that they might go to, but are now actually expected to remain within that area until they are deported on to their final destination. So when Babi Yar occurs, it's not the first major massacre to have yet taken place. The first major five-figure massacre was the one that was took place just a couple of months earlier in Kamenets-Podolsky. But Babi Yar, with its murder of roughly 33,771 people, according to those official records, was at least at that time the largest massacre to have yet taken place. And some of the individuals responsible for these crimes, and it's part of the tragedy of this history, I suppose, that it's easier to know their names than it is to know the names of their victims. But some of these people like Friedrich Jeckeln, for example, were subsequently responsible for then standardizing the procedures that they were putting into effect in these places of mass slaughter, such that they might be able to ensure a greater number of victims, such that they might be able to ensure a less in the way of resistance. And so Babi Yar has become somewhat infamous as one of those massacres in which they put those sorts of techniques into effect. Even though Babi Yar would subsequently be exceeded, there would be larger massacres that would claim the lives of a greater number of men, women and children in a similarly short space of time. I think one of the reasons that Babi Yar lives on in infamy is the fact that those victims themselves had followed the instructions that were given to them to register and to show up on the day in question, that they themselves had no inkling as to what the nature of their fate would soon be.
It's important to note that this event occurred before the January 20 meeting, 1942, about the final solution. This actually occurred before they had that. And from what you're saying, if correct me if I'm wrong, is that what occurred at Babi Yar kind of set up the apparatus and the techniques that they could use as they proceeded with the Holocaust program, for want of a better word.
Look, it's interesting actually that you mentioned that meeting in January of 1942. Originally, incidentally, that meeting was actually scheduled for late in 1941 and had been postponed. But it's interesting that even in as much as it took place in at the end of January in 42, there's a lot within sort of, I guess, popular culture and in popular retellings of that history. There's a very widespread, I suppose, misunderstanding that meeting was presumably where they laid the groundwork for the final solution. But the final solution by that stage had already been proceeding for some 6 months. If we're thinking about that particular meeting, which was held in Wannsee, which is a beautiful leafy suburb of Berlin, at the time that meeting took place, Jews were already being murdered in the death camp of Chelmno. The death camp of Belzec was already under construction. The plans for the death camps of Sobibor and Treblinka, not to mention of Birkenau at Auschwitz, were already in effect. The decisions that were made at that meeting, there's much about it that we will never know, but they weren't clearly laying the groundwork for the final solution. They might have been streamlining certain things or making particular decisions. But as we see from the case of Babi Yar, as we see from the case of Kamenets-Podolsky prior to that, and as we see from countless other smaller scale massacres that were proceeding in 1941, that official policy of murdering all of the Jews within Europe was one that had already been taken.
And you mentioned something that involved basically a confidence trick played upon Jewish people of Kiev, where they were told to just turn up and you're going to be resettled, bring your bags, bring your clothes, bring your valuables. Can you just tell us about that and about the flyer that went up around town on the 26th of September?
That's right. So this flyer actually encouraged Jews to register on a particular date for deportation. That as you mentioned, they are told to take a certain number of things with them. That there is a limitation as regards precisely what they are able to bring, and it is exactly as you said. It is a confidence trick. It's a ruse. It ensures a greater degree of cooperation. Though as time would go by, they would, on the one hand, get better at ensuring that cooperation, and on the other hand, be smoother at dealing with the resistance that may eventuate. The only reason that we are able to give so precise a figure as 33,771 victims is because when people did come and register, they recorded that information. And so the people who are actually responsible for the perpetration of these crimes, they are many and various. They are a police force, members of the German police. They are members of the SS. They answer to the SS. They're taking orders from the SS, and the SS is very interested in statistics like that. They want to know the number. They have no interest in knowing the kinds of things that we ourselves may more desire to know. They have no interest in their names, for example, or in anything relating to who those victims actually are. And so I think, in as much as we're taking this opportunity to commemorate those victims, I think it is worth being mindful of the fact that they did all have a separate identity, that we ourselves, to some degree, are guilty of that same erasure of their identity for which the Nazis were themselves responsible, just by repeating statistics, which I do myself all the time, where we mention 33,771 people, and it's very easy to overlook the fact that the murder of 33,771 people is not a thing that happens. It's 33,771 different things. And part of our responsibility as people who seek to preserve the memory of those victims is to, in some, to some degree, to whatever degree is actually possible, reclaim their identity, is to know something as to who were those people, and not just what it was that happened to them, and how it happened to them, but who might they have been in and of themselves. And I think that's a large part of what historians who seek to understand this history are really endeavouring today to try to do.
Just to unpack for a moment the scale of this event, 33,771 people shot in 2 days is a frightening insight into the machinery involved.
Yes, and I think if anything, it also gives the lie to another a very common misconception, which is that the Nazis eventually replaced these mass shootings with murders in death camps. That by taking people to death camps, they could better streamline the process of murdering them. Whereas we find throughout this history, the largest massacres to take place were all part of what Patrick Dubois refers to as the Holocaust of bullets. That the number of people who could be murdered by firearm is larger for the length of any individual massacre. And in fact, they continued with these sorts of massacres right up until the very end of the war.
I think it would probably be remiss of me not to ask you just go through the procedure of what happened to these people. They were told to turn up to a given location. From the meeting point where they believed they were going to be resettled, what happened?
Look, what we're given to understand is that people were not actually aware of what was transpiring until they were close enough to hear the gunfire. At which point, there was very little that they could do in the way of resistance. One of these techniques that people like Friedrich Jeckeln were responsible for coming up with as a way of standardizing the process was they would get victims to strip naked, and that served, I suppose, a dual purpose. On the one hand, it also ensured that there would be less in the way of resistance, it being a lot harder to meaningfully resist when one is unclothed. But they could also use that clothing. So clothing and shoes in particular would then be sent to German charities for the needy, the indigent. As the war progresses, of course, there'll be a number of charities that were taking advantage of this as people are being bombed out of their houses. And it's a curious form of doublethink that ends up taking place within Germany, because there is, as the war progresses, a growing number of people who are aware of where these clothes are coming from, especially as sometimes the stitching in the clothes from where stars have been removed, and this is something that happens in camps in particular, that might have badges and stars removed from clothing, might still be visible. And there may be a degree to which people choose to overlook that, or people choose not to be aware of the circumstances under which they are acquiring these clothes. Look, more than that, I regret to say there's a photographic record of the crimes perpetrated at Babi Yar, which is really quite awful.
You mentioned Friedrich Jeckeln.
Jeckeln, yeah. So that's J-E-C-K-E-L-N.
Okay. Can you just tell us a little bit about this guy?
Yeah, look, Friedrich Jeckeln was an Obergruppenführer. He's just a little bit like a general, effectively. He had a certain degree of, what's the word I'm looking for, organizational responsibility for some of those Einsatzgruppen, some of those SS organized killing squads that had SS and police officers in their chain of command. He had a particular sort of area of responsibility within the Baltic East, so that's Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia. But other crimes for which he also shared a certain degree of organizational responsibility included the massacre Kamenets-Podolsky that I mentioned previously, and the somewhat more famous massacre that occurred in Babi Yar, of which we're speaking today. And he received a special commendation for his role in standardizing pit shooting procedure. He came up with what was known by the rather awful name of the sardine method, by which he sort of determined that if you make people lie down in the pit prior to being shot on the tops of the bodies beneath them, you can ensure a greater number of people within the pit. And look, from archaeological excavations of some of these killing sites and from the forensic reports of what those archaeologists found, there are a number that conform to that, that we see that this is precisely what had happened to those victims. And there's a real a callous kind of coldness that's involved in this, that that rather than appreciating the horror of what it was that they were doing, they really saw this. So certainly he in particular really saw this as a logistical issue, and one that can therefore be overcome. He was actually captured at the end of the war. He was tried by a Russian court in Riga, and he was executed for his crimes. Some of the information that comes over in the course of his trial is also I think quite interesting. Look, I have to say, I find when it comes to material of this nature, I think that we all of us have a certain morbid fascination with these details. People oftentimes want to know more about how these things happened, and they want to understand, I think alongside with that, more about not only the apparatus of killing, but more about the psychology of the killers. And in my experience as a museum educator, I find that oftentimes these are the kinds of questions that students will ask as they seek to get their heads around the nature of these crimes. And I always feel a little uncomfortable with these questions, because while I too will confess to being drawn towards this and wanting to better understand it, all of these sorts of issues in many ways tell us more about the perpetrators than they tell us about the victims. That the victims are almost absent from this story, that they're robbed of the ability to make any meaningful decision, and we're looking at them at a point of the process where resistance is now entirely impossible. And so the kinds of things that people might do in order to preserve their dignity or in order to protect their children become, in the scheme of things, inconsequential. And I think, in as much as it is our desire to memorialize this event, it should also be our desire to memorialize these people. I think it's an unfortunate reality of this history, that such is the nature of genocide, how easy it is, without even much thought, to name 5, 10, 15 different perpetrators, and how difficult it is to name so much as a single victim, unless we are so privileged to have a relationship with somebody who is themselves a survivor, or somebody who can share with us information about their family members who perished on that particular day. They will go without an epitaph, whereas people like Friedrich Jeckeln will get to speak to their defense in Riga, and we can refer to them by name, as well as to the various people who had taken orders from him.
I think questions about detail have the purpose, I guess, of heightening the horror, or really just accentuating the horror. I think the intention behind such questions is to keep the atrocities from becoming abstract. And it's really just a matter of just heightening just the barbarity of it. And when you do that, it just sharpens the need to remember. Also, just with a wonderful point that you made about remembering the victims, there are a lot of, you know, pretty regrettable things about the internet, but I think one of the good things about the internet is that we have testimonials from survivors, both at the time recorded by the Soviets, and also some contemporary interviews made just a few years ago. Survivors relating their experience and finding out who they are, who the families were. So, Simon, I just wanted to just get a comment from you about one of the good things about YouTube is that it does provide an archive of these survivors. That allows us to get some insights into who the people were.
Absolutely. And look, there are some remarkable documentaries, and there's a great deal of published literature, both in the realm of memoir and in the realm of academic sort of historical appraisals of memoir and all of the various other types of sources, documentary and photographic and filmic that historians will make use of. So there are a lot of ways today in which we can connect with this history. And I think I agree with you that that perhaps the most profound and affirming of those ways is through the recollections of survivors, and I will just add to that that I have the great privilege of working at the Jewish Historical Centre in the Jewish Holocaust Centre in Melbourne, where we have some tens of thousands of recorded testimonies of survivors. It's a remarkable trove, and a number of survivors who volunteer their time sharing their stories, speaking of their experiences to students who come to the center, and it's a humbling phenomenon to be able to meet with a survivor and to hear from them, but I think it's all the more important right now when as you say, there is much online and regrettably not even just online that seeks to downplay and diminish those experiences, and we need to remember not just the dangers of this sort of extremism, but we also really need to remember the human component to this history as well. That it's not just the statistic, that these are events that affected the lives of real people, and that those individuals responsible for perpetrating these heinous crimes, they were themselves real people. This shows us what real people are capable of doing when they are so radicalized as to treat other lives as no more than a logistical issue that needs to be dealt with.
Before I ask you just about the aftermath and the legacy of Babi Yar, I just want to ask you about the issue of collaboration. There was a high degree of collaboration with the Nazis to carry this out. There's also the issue of the citizenry of the city, about why didn't they rise up and form a rebellion? Why didn't they resist? Why didn't they do something? What do you think about that issue? One imagines that people probably would have been absolutely petrified of being executed if they did such a thing. What do you think the reality was?
Well, there were serious reprisals for people who were engaged in partisan activity, or people who sought to resist the occupation or provide a safe haven for those who were deemed enemies of the state, particularly for those who seek to shelter Jews. And so I guess I can't judge those who don't make the heroic decision to do something. I can't possibly imagine what my response would be in a situation like that, where I find myself in a position of needing to make such an awful decision. And the fact that there are so many people who do risk their lives and so many people who do lose their lives in attempting to save Jews, the fact that there are so many partisans and people engaged in acts of resistance against the occupation should also not be forgotten, that we should appreciate that did exist, that there was a large degree of resistance of that nature. But at the same time, appreciate that doesn't erase the high degree of collaboration to which you also referred. And it's like all things, I guess it's complicated. Why do people collaborate? And the reasons they have for collaborating might be different in different areas. And look, I can say that so far as the non-Jewish citizens of Kiev are concerned, so far as the general Ukrainian population is concerned, they had, prior to the advance of the German army, been living as part of the Soviet Union. And we all appreciate the life in the Soviet Union is certainly, it's no picnic. There's a great deal of grief and resentment and frustration, and part of the sort of the way in which the SS presented themselves was as liberators, that they were there to liberate the local population from Soviet terror, and they presented to them an equation that works very well in propaganda, that the Jews in some sense are responsible for the Soviet Union, that communism is a Jewish plot, and that it basically allows the population a certain degree of lassitude to then take out their own frustration against Jews who are in their midst, and I think to a certain degree some of the collaboration that we see owes its origin to this sort of carte blanche that is given to them to now act with complete impunity against their own neighbors, but we also see centuries of anti-Jewish sentiment also coming to the fore. That Jews also work as a convenient scapegoat across all of Europe, because there is a history of either religiously inspired Jew hatred or economic-based anti-Semitism that they're also able to tap into at that time as well.
Can you just run us through the aftermath post-war? There was a trial in 1946, public hangings in Kiev of the Nazis responsible, then no commemoration park, no memorial park, or until the fall of the Soviet Union. In fact, there was neglect of the site as it was used as a dumping site for industrial tailings.
Look, I can tell you that while we might be struck by the enormity by the deafening nature of that silence when it comes to a place like Babi Yar, that general lack of memorial within many areas of the former Soviet Union is very much par for the course. Babi Yar is by no means exceptional in that respect, but there's a great many sites that only relatively recently might be graced with a plaque or a memorial of some description that indicates the nature of the crimes that had occurred there, and I think there's a number of reasons for that. But one of the reasons for that as well is a discomfort that persists today as regards the role of local Ukrainians in the perpetration of these crimes, a desire to see these as distinctly German crimes, and a desire to see the victims of these crimes as Soviet citizens rather than as Jews specifically. And that's extended to the memorialization of a number of camps. Perhaps most famously, of course, we have the situation of Auschwitz as well, how for a period of time amongst a number of Eastern European historians, they spoke of the victims of Auschwitz as being Soviets rather than as being Jews.
I've always been intrigued by this practice by the Nazis of covering up their atrocities. On the one hand, they're using the Aryan superiority argument and concept to do these things, that they're purifying, you know, the race, or they're just doing it kind of pretty much for the good of everybody. And then they want to cover it up. They don't want anyone to know what they did. It seems to be a massive contradiction in the way that they operated that I guess points to the psychosis behind what they were doing. What do you think?
Look, I think some things that they were responsible for doing, they took a kind of perverse pride in, and actually seemed surprised that others expressed a discomfort or dismay. But that's so far as what we might refer to as economic persecution or even sort of encouraged immigration are concerned. But when it comes to murder, that was something that even though they may have felt it was the right thing to do, and that a future generation will thank them, they appreciated that right now, these are not things that are going to fly. That you can't have the Allied powers find out about this. There was a big concern that it would be then used as atrocity propaganda, but they also didn't want their own citizens within Germany to be aware of this. So there was a very sort of concerted attempt to try to inoculate the general population of any awareness of what is transpiring to the East. And it's impossible. You can't do it. I mean, people have their brothers, their fathers, their uncles, their cousins are on long service leave, and people are talking. It becomes a very poorly kept secret. I think there is a degree to which some things people might find difficult to accept, that they couldn't quite believe the enormity of what was going on. But we find that amongst the victims as well, that even as the victims themselves have every reason to suppose that outside of the area that they are particularly familiar with, horrific crimes are being committed, there is still a degree to which the mind balks at the possibility of the enormity of it all, and that people, despite whatever concerns they may have about getting on trains or turning up to be sent to another location, they don't quite believe that if they do this, it is by necessity the end.
You touch on a very, very important point that I think a lot of people outside of Germany don't really understand, and that's the point of what the general population actually knew about what was going on, and that there was a huge resistance movement by the population. I think there might be a presumption that the average German went along with what Hitler was doing, when in fact that's not the case, is it?
Well, I think it's the case to a point. It's one of the fascinating and terrifying things about a totalitarianism is that the general population become complicit in the abrogation of their own rights. That there is a degree to which the population is, it's impossible to generalize. We're talking about over 60 million people who are living within Germany, but there is a degree to which the general population is allowing for the rights of certain groups to be taken away from them, and is effectively therefore complicit in those crimes. But there is a point, and it's very difficult to know when that line is crossed, where they are now themselves, without any meaningful way of actually objecting in any respect to what is transpiring. And the fact that there are resistance movements, I suppose one of the most famous and most celebrated is that of the White Rose, which was a student resistance group that was specifically responding to atrocities that are being perpetrated in the East. The fact that there are movements of this nature gives us a hope, I suppose, and deepens our appreciation for the fact that these people that we sometimes simply refer to as bystanders are people. They're regular people. They're every bit as nuanced and complicated as those victims and as those perpetrators. And then that, like the perpetrators, they are capable of making a decision. And we do see a number of instances of people whose decisions lead them towards acts of resistance, for which a great many of them are punished, and which very many of them are subsequently celebrated.